Hello friends, here I am going to discuss database management systems. The subject code is CS251. This is our very first lecture, hence we will discuss very basic terminologies and applications and many other things which are basic to database management systems. In the further lectures, we will discuss the different topics as they will come. So let me start. So what is the data? These are some known facts that can be recorded and have some implicit meaning. Like if I am discussing about the university system, then for the student, the name of the student, its age of the students, branch of that particular student are the data. Not only this, the image of that particular student and some related file is also the data. So what is the database? This is collection of data. Basically, data is random here, but if we provide some particular structure or in the some organized way, if we store the data in some organized way, then database is required to maintain or retrieve, modify, or for the operations, we need some package of softwares. These softwares help you to manage these databases, and these softwares are known as database management system. Here, what is the term mini word? If you are discussing in a particular context, like if you are discussing about the university system, if you are discussing about the rail reservation system, if you are discussing about the banking system, then the concern context are the mini word. To clear this thing, I want to give you an example. Like if you are discussing the university system, then we will discuss all about the admissions, faculty management, student management, hostel management, like all these operations. So the word is here, university system. This is the mini word. In the future in the coming slides, I will say this mini word as an inverse of discourse. Hence, both terms can be used interchangeably. So what is the term database systems? These are basically applications embedded with database or the database systems. Sometimes we will refer as an information system. Some authors also used to say these are the application systems. So what is the goal of DBMS? The goal of DBMS is to provide a way to store and retrieve database information conveniently and efficiently. The term conveniently and efficiently are very much important if we are discussing the database. This is a environment that demonstrates the database system. I have already informed that database systems are also known as application systems or the information systems, where database is embedded with the application programs. So how it works, this is your user interface or the user or the programmer who supplies the input data to the application program, and this will interact to the database, and this database will handle this database system, this database to maintain, keep or update the records which are placed inside the database. What is this stored database definitions? This is known as metadata. This is basically data about data. This term will come frequently when we move further some advanced lectures. Typical DBMS functionalities. As I have told you, this is a very first lecture. Hence, we will discuss all about the basic terminologies and basic concepts in the database management systems. So, what is the basic functionality of DBMS system? It defines a particular database in terms of database types, structures and constraints. What are the constraints? This shows some restrictions or limitations on the attributes. It constructs or loads the initial database contents on a secondary storage medium. It also helps to manipulate the database like retrieval, modification, or accessing the database from the different applications. It may be some standalone applications, desktop based, or the web applications. It also helps for processing and sharing by a set of concurrent users and application programs, yet keeping all data valid and consistent. Some other features like production or security measures to prevent unauthorized access, presentation and visualization of the data, maintaining the database and associated programs over the lifetime of the database applications. It means it helps to maintain the database for the lifetime. It's called database software and system maintenance. Some real-time examples of the database systems, like in the banking systems, you all are familiar with the online banking systems, where you see that how you pay the money by online using the database at the particular that banks. Airlines, you can easily reserve the seats with the help of such type of applications. In the university systems, you can see if you put your roll number, if you put your roll number or government number, you will see the profile of yours or the examination results of a particular person. Credit transactions, credit card and transactions. You will also see the use of database in the telecommunication systems. Also see the use of database in the finance, sales, online retailers, manufacturing and human resources. Some example of the database. What is the term conceptual data model? Only note this thing here. I will discuss this topic in the coming slides, particularly in my second session. The main word for the example we have taken here, university system or university environment as a main word, I have already told you. For the main word term, I will also use universe of discourse interchangeably. In the coming slides, I will also use DUOD, that is universe of discourse, in place of mini word, because some authors use universe of discourse and some authors use mini word. So, as I told you, what is the mini word? It is basically the context for which you are discussing. Like if you are discussing about the railway reservation, then the railway reservation system is a mini word. If you are discussing about the university system, then university system is a mini word. If you are discussing about the banking system, then banking is a mini word. So mini word entities, like first thing, what is the entities? These are basically building blocks. With the help of these building blocks, the whole application will build up. Like if you are discussing about the university, then students, faculties, other things, all these things, and sections, branches, departments, all these things constitutes to build the whole university system. Hence, all these are known as the entities of the mini world. Fine. Some relationships, sections are of specific courses, students take sections. What is the relationships? We will discuss clearly and more briefly in the coming sessions where I will discuss the relationship between the entities, where I will discuss one to many type of relationships. When the lecture will the topic will come, I will discuss in more detail. So only see these things here and note these things. I will discuss when the topic will come in the sequence. This is an example of tables in the database. Basically, here we are discussing the relational database, where the database keeps the relations, means the tables. Relations are known as tables. This is the example of, I know this is not very clear, but you can see only this is the structure of some tables. This is not relevant what is written inside these tables. You have to only note down that yes, this is some table. It has some attributes, means it has some columns. This is the relation. Table is relation. These fields are known as records. like this. So what is the main characteristics of the database approach? Actually, in the coming lectures, I will also discuss the disadvantages with the file systems which were there before the database systems. So comparatively, we are discussing the advantages of these database management systems. Main characteristic of the database approach is data abstraction. Abstraction means heading of something. So data abstraction means adding data. A data model is used to hide storage details and present the user with a conceptual view of the database. The graphs refer to the data model constructs rather than data storage details. It does not inform how data is storing into the database. Support of multiple views of the database. Each user may see a different view of database which describes only the data interested to that user. Sharing of data and multi-user transaction processing. Allowing a set of concurrent users to review from and to update the database. Concurrency and control within the DBMS guarantees that each transaction is correctly executed or aborted. Recovery subsystem ensures each completed transaction has its effect permanently recorded in the database. OLTP means online transaction processing is a major part of database applications. This allows hundreds of concurrent transactions to execute per second. It was not a complete list of advantages of using database approach. That was some conclusions which we have found after studying different papers or books or applying applications which are running on the different machines or databases. It can be a very big list if you will study or see the different applications, if you go with the different papers or books. So what is data? Who are the database users? Users may be divided into categories. First category, those who actually use and control the database content and those who design, develop and maintain database applications. These are basically actors on the scene. And the one is the workers behind the scene. Who are the workers behind the scene? It will discuss more clearly in the next slide. Here, those who design and develop the database, software and related tools, and the computer systems operators. So, who are the actors on the scene? Continues, this is the conclusion in the previous slide. These are the end users. This can be two types, casual and dev. Who are the end users? They use the data for queries, reports, and some of them update the database contents. Every end user can be categorized into casual or dev. What are the casual users? Access database occasionally when needed. These are the occasional accessors of the databases. Dev are parametric. They make up a large section of the end user population. They use previously well-defined functions in the form of client transactions against the database. Examples are bank tellers or reservation clerks who do this activity for an entire shift of operations. There are some sophisticated end users. These include business analysts, scientists, engineers, and other thoroughly familiar with the system capabilities. These have some expert level basically. Many use tools in the form of software packages that work closely with the stored database. Second one, next one is the standalone. Mostly maintain personal database using ready-to-use packaged applications. For example, text program user that creates its own internal database. Another example is user that maintains his own address books. This was the system which we were using before inception of the database systems. They have some advantages, a lot of disadvantages. We are focusing the disadvantages in advantages of the file processing systems. Before the evolution of DBMS, dedicated system known as file processing system were involved to handle the data repositories of the organizations. There are some limitations. These are three clear limitations which anyone can understand by only seeing this, that data redundancy and inconsistency are there. Data redundancy means one data is kept at different locations, and how this is inconsistent. If you are going to change the data at a particular location, you need to change this data at the every location or at the every file. But if you will forget to modify the data at any of the location, then more than one information is there for a query. It means there is redundancy, there is inconsistency in the system. You are supplying the same query and getting more than one answers. It means there is some confusion. It means there is inconsistency. For the consistent system, same data should be everywhere for a particular context or for the particular query. Difficulty in accessing the data, since these are maintained in the file, hence accessing this data is not very easy. It was also not very efficient in comparison to the databases. Data isolation is also a problem. Difficulty in enforcing integrity constraints to implement new constraints or some limitations, some restrictions in the functions is also a very big issue in the file processing systems. Atomicity problem, we will discuss what is the atomicity in our coming lectures, what is the atomicity in the distributed transactions. Difficulty in concurrency control, more than one user wants to access the same data or the same file, it will always create a problem when you are going with the file processing systems. And security is again a very big issue if we are discussing with the file processing systems. Now, what is the advantages of using the database approach? It basically control the redundancy in the data storage. It restricts unauthorized access to the data. It also provides persistent storage for program objects in object-oriented data. This is some new type of database we will discuss in the coming chapters. It provides storage structures for efficient query processing. It provides backup and recovery services. It also provides multiple interfaces to different class of users. Different class of users have the different permissions or different level of accessing authentications. Hence, the different interfaces will be there for the different type of users. The representation, it also represents complex relationship among data. It enforces integrity constraints on the database, which was a big factor when we were discussing the file processing systems. Drawing inference and action from the stored data using deductive and active users. Some additional implications of using the database approach. Potential for enforcing standards. This is very crucial for the success of database application in large organizations. Standards refer to data item names, display formats, screens, report structures, metadata, that is the data about data, web page layouts, etc. Reduced application development time. Incremental time to add each new application is reduced. Flexibility to change data structure. It also provides a very good flexibility. Database structure may evolve as new requirements are defined. It has also availability of current information. Economies of scale. Wasteful overlap of resources and personnel can be avoided by consolidating data and applications across departments. Historical development of database technology. Now we are seeing here how the evolution offload, database takes it to the process. This is the early database applications. The hierarchical and network model were introduced in mid 1960s and dominated using during the 70s. Basically, it was for the on the last 10 years, but still we are using hierarchical systems, database systems in the most of the applications. Relational database model. What happens is basically in hierarchical, there is a parent-child relationships are there. One parent is there, two childs are there. Next level also is there. If you see Windows XP is designed on the concept of hierarchical. If you discuss about the network models, it means it was basically based on relationships. 1:2 relationship was there. That was the network models. Now, what is the relational model based systems? Here, tables are relations. Relational models were originally introduced in 1970s. Was heavily researched and experimented within IBM research and several universities. Relational database products emerged in early 1980s. Object-oriented and emerging applications. Object-oriented database management system, that is the OODBMS, object-oriented database management system, were introduced in 1980s and early 90s to cater to the need of complex data processing in CAD and other applications. Their use has not taken off much. Many relational database management systems have incorporated with object databases concepts, leading to create a new database technology that was the object relational database management system, ORDBMS. Fine. On the data on the web at e-commerce applications, web contains data in HTML. Fine. With the link amount among the pages, this is very much clear to all. This is not a new thing. But this has given rise to a new set of applications, and e-commerce is using new standard like XML, extended markup language, also allow database updates through web pages. Extended database capabilities, some new features, new functionality is being added to DBMS in the following areas like scientific application. These are some new functionalities we have added. Now the database is used in some different areas, which are like here scientific applications, XML, image storage and management, audio and video data management, data warehousing, data mining, special data management, time series and historical data management. The above details gives rise to new research and development in incorporating new data types, complex data structures, new operations and storage and indexing schemes in the database systems. When not to use a database management system? Main inhibitors cost of using a database, high initial investment and possible need for the additional hardware. Overhead for providing generally security, concurrency control, recovery and integrity functions when a DBMS may be unnecessary. If the database and applications are simple, well defined, not expected to change, then it is not advised to use the DBMS. If the database and applications are simple, very much simple applications are there, well defined, and you are thinking this is static. In the future or in the time, it is not going to change. Hence, it is not very much advisable to use database system. If there are stringent real-time requirements that may not be met because of DBMS overhead, if access to data by multiple is not there, when no DBMS may suffix, if the database system is not able to handle the complexity of database, of the data, sorry, because of logic limitations. If the database users need special operation not supported by the DBMS, if the DBMS is not going to support some operation, you cannot use this type of particular database in the systems. So summary is that type of databases, what we have discussed here, different type of databases and database applications, basic definitions, where we have discussed the definition of database management system, mini world, where I have also told you that you can use UOD, that is the inverse of discourse, for the in place of mini world. We have also used the term like information system or application programs or application systems. We have also discussed environment of the application programs or database systems. And then we have seen an example of tables, where I told you that the tables are relations basically having the attributes and the rows as the records. Attributes are the fields basically. We have discussed a mini world like university system. If I give you an example, if I say you what is the if I say you that this is about the management system, banking management system, then you will say accounts, customers, lizards, bank details, transfer of money, like this. These are the entities of this particular system, and this particular system is known as mini world here in this context. Basically, mini world is the context for you are discussing here. Then we have discussed different characteristics of the database approach. What are the different advantages, disadvantages, using or when to use, when not to use. What are the different comparative advantages of database in comparison to the file management system or file transfer processing. What are the disadvantages of that, like this. Then we have discussed when not to use the databases. So this was the all about the basics of database. One more thing, what is the practical example, or what we can see that why a person is moving to study the database, the very genuine reason why people are moving to study the database. If you see 30 years back, when this type of systems are not there, this type of applications were not there, which we are using today in the banking, railways, air ticket bookings, like this. Suppose an example, if there was LIC company which used to manage your insurance, like this. You have taken some policy and the due date has come, then the company will send you a paper or a letter to inform you that Mr. X, you have to submit your premium to continue the policy. You will receive it, you will take a leave from your office, you will book a car, or by using your bike, you will go to the company, you will be in a queue, discuss with the clerk in front of you, then fill a form, and finally you will submit your money, then you will take a receipt, then you will put in your file for the future references. The whole thing will take some time. Even you will have to take the leave from your office, you will waste a lot of paper, you will waste the money for the expenses like this, and you will be in the queue, suffer from these type of things. But think about it today, what you will do? When the date of premium due date will come, the company will send you an email, you will receive, you will see the mail and come to know, yes, the date has been come and I need to submit the money, the premium. You will directly go to the website of that particular insurance company or LIC. You will go on the link and fill the form, select the money, put the money in the LIC site, will redirect you to the corresponding bank's database. You will submit your money, come back again to the LIC. LIC's website, where you will find your receipt for the future use. For doing all these things, you have to not even move for a single inch from your chair. This is the importance of using such type of applications where databases are involved, where you can keep the data at some centralized place, or in future phases, we will also keep data in decentralized way. but you can keep the data in some databases in some particular fashion, and it will help you to access this database for your future use. Hence, these are the reasons why we are moving from the old fashion to the database management system, where we will use to keep database in a particular fashion, in a very organized fashion, such that in future you will use this data very efficiently and very effectively and very conveniently also. So these are the reasons why we are studying the database management system. Thank you for watching this session. In the next session we will discuss about the concept. Hello students, here we are going to discuss database management system. This is our second session on this particular topic. In our previous lecture we have discussed about type of databases and their applications. We have also discussed basic definitions of different terminologies like data, database management system, mini board. I have also told you can also use universe of discourse in place of mini board. We have also understood what is the database management system. It was a set of softwares that manipulate or handle the database management systems. And finally, we have also discussed about the application programs or information systems. In this particular lecture, I will again give a few minutes on the information system. Then we have discussed different functionalities of the database management system. We have also discussed about the different examples of the database management systems, where we have discussed about the mini board university. I have also illustrated this with the example of banking systems and other like university system, banking system. These are the simpler, not the simpler, but the concepts which we follow to develop this type of applications are the same. Next, we have also discussed the main characteristics of a database approach in comparison to the file processing systems. We have discussed about the different drawbacks of the file processing systems. That was slow, very much slow, and there were many issues. Like if you want to introduce some integrity constraints, if you want to see in the terms of security, in the terms of efficiency, like this, and many more issues were there, which are resolved in if you are going with the database management systems. We have also seen the different users, where some users were on the scene and some were behind the scene. What were there? Like name users, casual users, the sophisticated users, which were the scientists and engineers, like such type of users who know the characteristics and capabilities of the system. They are more sophisticated, and many other type of users also. Finally, we have discussed advantages of the database approach. This was again we have studied in comparison to the file processing system and something more which were new. Which we have introduced during the study of data management systems. We have also discussed that there are some new features which we need to implement. Hence, there is a big resource on the data management system to incorporate such type of requirements, like in the scientific requirements, like this. And finally, we have also discussed where the use of database is not very much feasible. For an example, if the content is completely static, not going to change with time, and no concrete user is there, then in this cases it is not very useful or not very convenient, not very feasible to use the database management systems. Now, in this lecture, we are going to discuss next topic related to the previous topic, that one is the conceptual design. We are going to discuss here conceptual design, a simplified database management process. Here, in the coming three slides, I will discuss all about the design process for a given project or a given information system. You can say a simplified database design process. As I told you, if you are analyzing different informations of some entity, like I am saying about the student, his name, his age, his branch, his image, all the data having some meaning basically. And the collection is the database. And to handle this database, you need a packages of softwares, and these are known as database management system. But still, if you have only database management system, you cannot do many more things. Like this database management system is like an engine. You cannot go with the engine, you cannot sit on the engine to go here and there. You need a car based on that engine, you need a bus based on that engine. The layering of this information or layering of this application that creates, that converts an engine into an engine plus car, engine plus bus system is information system. If we are discussing information system or application systems, it means database is embedded as a part with the applications. Like if you are discussing about the university system, then application is there and database is embedded with that application. If you are discussing about the banking system, then banking software is there, and database management system is embedded with that. If you are discussing about the railway system, application is there by which you are accessing your seats, you are reserving your seats, canceling your seats, but it is again embedded with some database management system. So when a client is coming to you or you are discussing about some project or some application, you people sit together and you will listen everything what a client is saying to you. Based on the discussions, it's your task to analyze or to collect these informations into two categories. This is basically UOD. UOD is the context for which you are going to do your exercise or for which you are going to develop some project or information system. Like as I have told you, UOD, universe of discourse, that is the mini world. You have already listened this word. This is the mini world, like university system, like banking system, like railway system, like airlines. These are the universe of discourse or mini world for which we are going to develop some project. If the client is coming, he or she will give all the details to you. It's your responsibility that here what is saying, and categorize all these requirements into two categories. One is the database requirement and second one is the functional requirement. Database requirement, also known as data requirement, it will go with the database and this will go with the programming. All what is saying, what he is referring to store, how it will store, what it will store, why, what the relationship between the databases, all are covered in the database requirements. And this shows the functionalities. This is the functional requirement. This is the very first part of the database design process. In the next step, in the second step, what was the output of the first step? That was the database requirement. This is the very high level database requirements. This is the first requirement. It will be input to the next step. What in the next slide? It was the database requirement. It was the output of that previous slide. Database requirement and the functional requirement. The database requirement, as you will hear or collect all the data requirements which is used to go with the database, you need to find the relationship between the data. As you will hear or collect all the data requirement, it's your responsibility to show the relationship between the data as with the understanding coming from the client. Finally, you will draw all the relationship on the paper following the some standard rules. This is not very much formal. You will write all these things, data, their relations on the some charts, some paper. Finally, you will fine autofield is a conceptual schema. This is not very much formal, but still it is following some formula or some notations. But this is not for the computer. This is for you and for the client. You will hear all the things what the client is saying. You will find the database requirements. You will find the relationships among the data. You will put all this relationship on a paper. You will understand and put on the paper. You will show this paper to the client to ask, see it and tell what I am understanding. Is it correct or not? The client will say yes, it is correct, or there is some modifications. If there are some modifications, he will again modify this thing, again show this chart to the client. This is completely for understanding, mutual understanding for you and for the client. This is completely not for the directly not for the computer system. First, you people have to make it confirm that yes, what we have to design, then go to the computer. Second one is the functional requirement, where you will study or analyze the functional requirements. Like if you are discussing about the banking system, then you have to familiar with the opening of accounts, closing of accounts, ledgers, clients, transfer of money, like this, all the operations which are used in the banking systems. So for this, you will analyze all these things with the help of you will analyze yourself, but after asking all these things from the client, what he required, what he wants in the final system. And finally, the output is the high level transaction specifications. This process is completely independent to the database and programming language. This is completely informal, where you will only discuss with the client what he wants for his project or for his application. People will sit together, discuss all these things, come to a conclusion, finally agree on some conclusion, and now you will move to the next step. And that step will be the next step will be the database dependent. How this is the output of this step, basically step 2, conceptual schema and the high level transaction specification. Come to the third step, where conceptual schema will now map to a physical design. This is dependent on the database, though DB2 or Oracle are the based on the relational database, but still having some variations. In this step, basically, you have a conceptual schema, that was the relationship between the data, and now this is the time you have to map this schema to the physical database that will store in some database. Here you have to consider the database. This is also affected with the high level transaction specifications, like which function is going to update, change, or going to implement on which table. Some authors also used to say there are some transactions which are related, then put these transactions all together. That will helpful to you, or that will make your system more efficient. Finally, the final output will be the internal schema. Here, after higher transition specification, this is application design, then it will be implemented, and then application software that will be embedded in the database. All these things will be covered in the chapter transactions. We will discuss all these things in the more refinements and more new terminologies. We will discuss the transactions chapter. So, what is the very important point which we have find here? That is the conceptual schema. See the previous slide. This was the conceptual schema. How this was drawn? It was information collected from your client in a very few formal way, having some not a very high level of specification, having some a very few formal. You can say it is basically informal basically, where you take the information in terms of data basically, you will find the relationship, you will draw on a paper and show to your client that see, this is what I have understood from the discussion. Is it correct or not? client will make okay or not. He will say, no, you have to modify these things. This is not for the computer, this is for you people, you and the client. So, formally, how we will discuss this thing? What is the principal schema? It is output of the high level conceptual design. It is concise description of the data requirements of users. It includes description of entity types, relationship and constraints. So what is the entity type? We will discuss. What is the relationships? We will discuss in the next lecture. And what are the constraints? We will also discuss these things in the next lecture when the topic will come in proper sequence. But for this time, I want to say a very few information about these things. Entity type is basically type of entities which constitutes the whole system. Like if you are discussing about the university, then departments are the entity type, students are the entity type, faculties are the entity type, like this. Relationship. What is the relationship between the faculty and department, branches and students, subjects and branches? These are the relationship between the entities. What is the constraints? These are some restrictions or limitations. Like I am saying that if you are going to open an account, in some bank, it is the restriction by that particular bank that you must have minimum of 1,000 rupees in your account. So if you are going without any money to open an account, the bank will not allow you to open the account. So this is the restriction. If you are saying that if you are going to take admission into B.Tech curriculum, then it is required that you must be passed by intermediate. Hence, if you are not passed intermediate, you will not get admission into the B.Tech curriculum. This is the restriction or this is the constraint. Such type of constraint will be imposed in the programming or also posed on the database fields. When the topic will come, we will discuss more formally with the more discussion, with the more and more examples. And there are no implementation details in the conceptual design. I have told you that this is for you and the customer only. This is not for the computer. This provides ease to understand, ease to communicate with the non-technical users. These are the basic users. So hope conceptual schema is clear to you, because this is a very important term that will repeatedly come into the syllabus. Example of some company database. Company is constituted with the help of departments, projects, employees and dependents and many more things also. Departments are characterized with the help of name, department ID and manager. Projects are characterized by project ID, project name. Employees are characterized by their name, PAN number, address, salary, gender, date of birth and other parameters also, attributes also. Dependents are characterized by their name, address, gender, date of birth, relationship with the employees also. Basically, these are the things which constitute the whole company database. You can see here there are two parts. One is in the left and another is in the right. If you will characterize these things, the left parts are the entity types and these are the corresponding attributes, I can say attributes of the particular entity. If I will say that the HR department, then it means HR department is a entity of which type? Department's type. And what it has the structure, it will have a name, it will have an ID, it will have a manager and other things. What the attributes you have defined for a particular type or a particular type will be there with each example or will be there with each entity of that particular type. And these are the attributes by which an entity type is defined. Here we are showing you example how to represent entities. Here entities are represented with the help of rectangles, and the attributes are used to represent with the this type of circles. These are some oval like circles, basically not a complete circles. These are slightly circuit but more nearer to the ovals. This is the way to connect the attributes with the entity. This is the like balloon type structure, where this is the entity and these are the attributes related to that particular or associated to that particular entity. An entity represents an object of the real world that has an independent existence. These are represented by the rectangles. An entity has attributes, that is properties that describe it. Some attribute types. There are different types of attributes. First one is the simple, second one is the composite. We are going to compare with the definition. What is the simple attribute? One value associated with an attribute is known as simple attribute. Like my age is 30. The age is an attribute and its simple value is a simple value attribute. And composite attribute is made up with one or more simple or composite attributes. Like in many countries, the names are referred with the first name, middle name and last name. This is a very good example of composite attributes. Single value and multi-valued attributes. A single value attribute is described by one value, like age is 30. One person or one student has a single age. It has a single value, not like a multi-valued. Multi-valued means like a student has or person has more than one mobiles. Means if I have two mobile numbers, then I have if we discuss about the mobile number as an attribute, then it is a multi-value. Two mobile numbers are associated with me. A multi-value is described by many values, like color of the peacock. For example, here new example is there. Like color of peacock is defined by different colors. Even you will see, if you discuss about the color of peacock, you will see different colors at the peacock. This is defined by the multi-value attributes. Stored and derived attributes. What are the stored attributes? An attribute whose value can be inferred from value of derived value attributes. Stored values are those values which are usually not changed. You have stored the value and directly you will retrieve when it is required. Let's see, if this is not the case, this one case, then this attribute value. For example, you have stored age is 30. Now when I need to retrieve this value, I will find my age is 30. But what about if I will read this value after 5 years? After 5 years, will I still 30? No, it will be more than 30, that is 35 years. But if you have stored my age value is 30 and you will retrieve after 5 years, what it will be? It will be still 30, but it is not correct. After 5 years, it will be 35. How these things will be resolved? This is resolved by the derived value. How I will read that value and I will the date of that value, today's date, I will subtract and find the current value. This is known as derived value. This is in a more fashion to use, and this is used with the date of birth type of attributes, date of joinings type of attributes. What is the null value? Attributes that do not have any applicable value are said to have null value. It is very, very important is that it is different from zero, unknown or missing value. For an example, consider a student can take one subject as an elective among the four subjects. There are four elective subjects, but a student can take only one elective subject. When the numbers will be assigned to him, or grades will be assigned to him, he will be assigned by grade for a particular elective subject. And what about the other three? Will that student be awarded by zero or by other value? It is just like not applicable. This null value is just like not applicable. In this case, we can use null attributes. Entity types and entity sets. As I discussed in my previous slides, what is entity types? It basically shows a structure of a type of entity. Formally, we can show an entity type defines collection of entities having the same type, like departments. If you describe departments as an entity type, then it has some ID, some name. If you will take an example like HR department, it must have a type, an ID, a name that was previously defined in its type. Any specific collection of the entity or particular type is called an entity set. For example, you have taken HR department, finance department together. These are the two departments which are different but from the same set, same type, same department type, having the common properties. These are known as the entity set. An entity type describes the schema or intention for the entity set. Now, some ER notations. Formally, we will discuss the ER notations. In our coming lectures, we will draw some ER diagrams for the given problems. Here, we are going to discuss the different notations which are in fashion to use for the designing of ER diagrams. So, we have frequently discussing the entity. Again, these terms come how to represent. In my previous slide, I have already informed you that entities are represented with the help of rectangles. Not the solid integral, this is only for the presentation. These are with the help of rectangles. Attributes of particular entity. Attributes of particular entity are represented with the circuit or oval-like structures. Look like a balloon type or lit balloon type structure which are related with lines like this. Like student have name, birth date, have some roll number like this. Composite attributes. Now in this slide we have discussed the composite attributes, where attributes are constituted with the help of more than one attributes, like your name having first name, middle name and last name. These are combination of one or more simple or composite attributes. This is represented with the help of nested attributes. Name is the attribute of a student, and this is again characterized with the first name and last name. This is the composite structure basically. Attribute has some attributes. Multivalued. The multivalued attributes are depicted by the double line ellipse like this one. A student can have more than one phone numbers. This is possible. Many more students are there, persons are there, five students only, many more persons are there, they can have more than one phone number. This is not only example. You can have more than other examples, more other examples to show the multivalued attributes. Derived attributes are depicted by the dashed ellipse. This one, derived attributes. If you are deriving some value from the stored value, like I have told you, I have stored my date of birth in my database. Today I want to fetch my age. I will fetch today's date and the stored date. The difference will be the up to date data of birth. If I will fetch the date of birth after 5 years, that will be again the up to date data of birth. This is the derived, and this is way. Just lines on the ellipse is a way to represent the derived attributes. So in this way, in this particular lecture, we have discussed about the information projects, information systems, application systems, or database systems, where I have informed you that database system is like a engine, and you cannot sit on the engine and go here and there. You need a layering, like a bus or the cars, and this layering is the information systems or your projects, where database system is embedded to that projects. I have discussed the development process for the database system projects, where I have discussed three different steps, from first step to third step, where you can find the final projects. Here we started with the requirement analysis, that was of the two types. First was related with the database, that is database requirements. Second one was the functional requirements, and finally you have got, after moving from the different steps, you have formed the final application program or the information system, where database was embedded with that. After that, we have seen some example of some sort of example to demonstrate the universe of discourse, where we have shown you the different entities. We have also discussed how different attributes, their types with their examples. Finally, we have discussed how to represent the entities, how to represent the attributes, how to represent different attributes. This was the discussion about the conceptual design. We have also discussed what is the conceptual schema. That was for you and the non-technical user. This was not for the computers. As it is, this need to place into some more physical or formal way to put the into the databases like this. In the coming lectures, in the next lecture, we will discuss some practical examples of the real world, where examples will be there, problems will be there. We will analyze these problems, we will find out their requirements, and based on these requirements, we will draw some ER diagrams. These are very much important when we are discussing the design process. Thank you for watching this lecture. Thank you so much.